Hello, and welcome to the TI Precision Lab discussing the protection of multiplexers against electrical overstress conditions. In this video, we'll discuss what causes electrical overstress damage, as well as some methods for protecting against the damage using external components. Many of the concepts described in this video are also covered in TIPL 1401 to 1414, so you should review this material to get a more complete understanding of this subject. Before moving to the protection of multiplexer circuits, let's first review the basic construction of a CMOS switch and its characteristics. The slide here shows the typical construction of a CMOS switch. A CMOS switch is formed by connecting an N-channel MOSFET and a P-channel MOSFET in parallel, as shown here. This particular arrangement allows us to switch both positive and negative voltages at the output with equal ease. A logic high signal at the gate of the NMOS will enable this MOSFET and allow negative voltages to pass to the output, while a logic low at the gate of the PMOS will enable this MOSFET and allow positive voltages to pass to the output. The inverter is used to turn on both transistors when a logic high input is applied to the control signal and turn off both transistors with a logic low input. Several CMOS switches can be combined with some simple logic control to create a multiplexer. Although the CMOS switch input pin and output pin are interchangeable, for simplicity, we will assume the source pin as the input and the drain pin as the output of the CMOS switch. Electrostatic discharge, or ESD, is a sudden flow of current that occurs when two bodies with a charge imbalance are brought near each other. When proper precautions are not taken, ESD can damage semiconductor devices. Most semiconductor devices have internal ESD protection diodes, which are clamped to either VDD or VSS or both. The primary function of these internal ESD diodes is to give protection against ESD events during assembly and test of the devices. These diodes have a typical forward voltage in the range of 0.4 to 0.7 volts and a current carrying capacity of 10 to 30 milliamps. These diodes connected between the input pins and VDD or VSS are reverse biased under normal operating conditions, but become forward biased as the inputs rise above the positive supply voltage or below the negative supply voltage. ESD and electrical overstress for amplifiers is covered in TIPL 1401 to 1414, and many of the concepts covered in this series are general and apply to all semiconductor devices. It is recommended that you review this material to get a deeper understanding of ESD and electrical overstress, or EOS. This video will focus on overstress problems that are specific to multiplexers. One common electrical overstress issue, known as latchup, can occur when an input signal is higher than the supply rail VDD or lower than the supply rail VSS. In this state, it is possible to trigger a parasitic SCR, or silicon-controlled rectifier, provided that the input signal source has enough drive strength to turn on this SCR structure. The next few slides will cover the semiconductor physics on how this can happen and a method for preventing this problem. The figure on the left shows a cross-section of the CMOS switch that we discussed on the previous page. The left-hand structure is an NMOS transistor and a PMOS transistor is on the right-hand side. However, for this discussion, we are really focusing on the parasitic structures that occur as part of this circuit. The parasitic structures shown on the right-hand side of the page are unintended transistors that are normally reverse biased. In general, the isolation of the individual diodes, transistors, and capacitors from each other in an integrated circuit is achieved by reverse biased PN junctions. This can be achieved by connecting P-doped substrates to the most negative voltages in the system and connecting an N-doped well with positive voltages in the system. However, these PN junctions form NPN and PNP structures with other adjacent junctions. The result of this is parasitic NPN or PNP transistors, which can be undesirably activated. The current gain of these transistors is usually very small, with a beta of less than 1. As a result, considerable input current is usually necessary to activate these transistors. A typical example for the undesirable interaction between various PN junctions is the well-known phenomenon of latchup, which can occur with CMOS circuits and with bi-CMOS circuits that have similar structures. A thyristor formed from parasitic transistors is triggered and generates a short circuit in the device. The figure on the left shows the arrangement of the P and N doped regions in the CMOS circuit, and the figure on the right shows the parasitic SCR. R-well and RS are resistances offered by the N-doped well and substrate. We will now see how this latch-up condition is triggered. Frequently, multiplexers are at the front end of the data acquisition system. Inputs to multiplexers can be from sensors which are placed remotely. In these kinds of applications, a common problem is that the multiplexer could see an overvoltage transient on its input channels. If there is a voltage applied at D2 or S2 that is more positive than the supply voltage VDD, current will flow into the gate of the thyristor and turn on transistor Q1. Similarly, transistor Q2 can also be triggered by applying a voltage more negative than VSS at D1 or S1. If the amplitude and duration of the current are sufficient, the thyristor is triggered. Once triggered, the thyristor very rapidly enters a very low resistive state. In this state, a very high current flows, which will quickly lead to the destruction of the component. The thyristor can be switched off again only by switching off the supply voltage. We will now see how latch-up can be avoided by the simplest of techniques. This slide shows one of the protection methods that can be used to avoid a latch-up. A series diode in the VDD and VSS path blocks the gate current of the thyristor and prevents the latch-up condition. In other words, during an event that would normally trigger the SCR, the diodes are reverse biased, so they prevent latch-up. During normal multiplexer operation, the diodes are forward biased, so the supply will effectively be reduced by a diode drop. Using series diodes on the supply is one very simple and effective method to protect against over-latch-up. One minor disadvantage, however, is that it does slightly limit the linear input and output range of the multiplexer. This limitation is related to the fact that each supply voltage is effectively reduced by one diode drop. For example, let's assume the forward drop of our diodes are 0.7 volts. If you have a multiplexer with plus and minus 10 volt supplies, then the effective supply is reduced to plus and minus 9.3 volts. So for this example, the I/O swing is limited to 9.3 volts. One other consideration when selecting the blocking diode is its reverse breakdown voltage. You will need to choose the reverse breakdown voltage based on the maximum input overvoltage and applied VDD and VSS values. Before we begin discussing other methods for protecting multiplexers from overstress voltage, we will do a short review of the transient voltage suppressor diode, or TVS. The TVS diode has the same functionality as a Zener diode, except that it is specifically designed to turn on very quickly and absorb large transient powers. There are two different categories of TVS, unidirectional and bidirectional. The bidirectional allows for both positive and negative voltages to be applied across it before it turns on. For this reason, the bidirectional device is normally used to limit a signal input to a safe level. The unidirectional TVS acts like a traditional Zener diode. That is, it has a forward voltage drop of about 0.7 volts and its voltage is limited in the negative direction by the breakdown voltage. For this reason, the unidirectional TVS is often used for supply over voltage protection. Normally, the TVS is selected based on the reverse standoff voltage called VR. The reverse standoff voltage is the voltage at which the TVS diode leakage is defined. For example, if the supply voltage is set to 15 volts, a reverse standoff voltage of 15 volts is selected to assure that the diode is normally off and has low leakage during normal operating conditions. Ideally, the breakdown voltage will be lower than the absolute maximum supply rating so that the TVS diode will turn on and protect the device in an overvoltage condition. Later, we will show an example of selecting a TVS diode. This slide shows another approach of protecting a multiplexer during an overvoltage condition. A simple series resistor in the input path can limit the current during an overvoltage condition. The absolute maximum ratings for the input current of the MUX36 SO8 device is limited to 30 milliamps. A more common rating for the absolute maximum input current is 10 milliamps. The absolute maximum input current is the continuous current that the ESD diodes can sustain without damage. During the input overvoltage condition, the internal ESD diodes turn on and direct current towards the positive or negative supply depending on the polarity of the input signal. In practice, many supply voltages are generated using low dropout regulators, or LDOs. many LDOs cannot sink current. For this reason, it is very important to include a transient voltage suppressor to clamp the supply voltage to a safe level. Without the transient voltage suppressor, the input overvoltage may be just directed to the supply voltage, resulting in an overvoltage condition on the supply. The TVS diode also acts as a protection for any transient overvoltages or reverse voltages on the power supply. It is important to use a unidirectional transient voltage suppressor diode as opposed to a bidirectional voltage suppressor for supply protection, as the unidirectional device will limit reverse supply voltages to 0.7 volts. Here we show an example of selecting the input protection resistor. In this example, the input overvoltage is 20 volts, and the supply voltage is set to 15. Assuming the supply stays constant during overvoltage and that the internal ESD diodes drop 0.7 volts, the voltage across the protection resistor is equal to Vn minus VDD minus VBE, which is 20 volts minus 15 volts minus 0.7 volts. It is good practice to limit ESD diode current to 20% of the absolute maximum value in case of overvoltage events. This will ensure that the power dissipation in the device is lower in the overvoltage condition. In this case, we are taking the conservative approach and setting the maximum input fault current to be 5 milliamps. This will set the input protection resistor to 860 ohms or 910 ohms when choosing a standard value. In this slide, we will show the measured results for the multiplexer with the current limiting input resistor protection scheme that we just discussed. Notice in this example that the circuit is configured in a single supply configuration. That is, VDD equals 12 volts and VSS equals ground. The input signal is a sinusoidal 20 volt peak-to-peak signal and is offset by 7 volts, so that the input ranges from negative 3 volts to positive 17 volts. This input range will turn on the ESD diodes on both the positive and negative peak. The 1 k-ohm input resistor limits the input current to a safe level. You can see that the output voltage clips at 0.7 volts above and below the supply voltages. This slide shows the same protection scheme with a dual plus and minus 15 volt supply. In this case, a 40 volt peak-to-peak or 20 volt peak input signal is applied with no DC offset. Again, the ESD diodes turn on and direct the overvoltage to the supplies. The 1 k-ohm input resistor limits current to prevent damage to the device. Notice that the output waveform is clipped or limited to a diode drop beyond the supply voltage. This slide highlights another common method of protecting a multiplexer during an overvoltage condition. Instead of relying on internal ESD diodes, Schottky diodes are connected from the input terminal to each supply voltage as shown. Schottky diodes have a typical forward drop of 0.2 to 0.4 volts. Generally, ESD diodes have a forward voltage in the range of 0.6 to 0.7 volts. Thus, the overstress current flows through the external diodes and not through the device's internal diodes, thus avoiding any excessive heat dissipation across the device. Furthermore, the Schottky diodes effectively prevent the inputs from exceeding the supply voltage by more than 0.2 to 0.4 volts, thereby preventing latchup conditions. These diodes also have a higher current carrying capacity compared to the internal ESD diodes. A series resistor limits the current flowing through the Schottky diodes. It is also recommended to include a zener or TVS clamp at VDD and VSS to clamp the maximum supply voltage within datasheet specifications. This device is important as many LDO power supplies are not capable of sinking current, so an overvoltage input signal could be directed through the ESD diodes to the supply. Including the TVS diode on the supply prevents input overstress from becoming an overstress problem on the supply. Here we are not looking at an input protection scheme, but rather we are considering how overstress of an off-channel will impact the signal passed through the on-channel. Typically, multiplexer input channels can be interfaced with various sensors, and it is possible that the selected channel may have an input voltage within the multiplexer datasheet limitations, but an overvoltage might be applied to a channel which is not selected. In this diagram, we can see that channel 1 is selected and channel 2 is off. The input signal on channel 1 is inside the absolute maximum ratings, but an overvoltage condition appears on channel S2. Besides potentially damaging the device, the overvoltage of the off channel can feed through to the output. This coupling of the off-channel signal to the output corrupts the expected output signal. In the next slide, we will look at real-world measured results. This slide highlights the MUX36 SO8 performance when channel S1 is on and an overvoltage condition occurs on channel S2. The overvoltage signal applied to the off-channel is a sinusoidal 16-volt peak-to-peak signal and is offset by 7 volts, so that the input ranges from negative 1 volts to positive 15 volts. The on-channel has a 5-volt DC input signal, so that the output should be a 5-volt DC signal. Notice that when the overvoltage condition occurs on the off-channel, the output channel of the MUX36 SO8 follows that signal. That is, the overvoltage signal feeds through to the output signal. This is an undesirable effect that not only corrupts the output signal, but also could damage the circuit that is interfaced to the output of the multiplexer. This slide highlights a solution for the case where the overvoltage fault occurs on an off channel. A Zener or TVS diode is used to clamp the input channel within the absolute maximum input range. Note that a unidirectional TVS diode is normally used for a single supply configuration and a bidirectional TVS diode is used for a bipolar supply. The clamping voltage is selected in such a way that it should effectively clamp each channel voltage so that the input does not exceed VDD or VSS applied to the device. A series resistor acts as a current limiting resistor. You should take care to understand the parasitic capacitance and leakage currents of the input clamp to be confident that your system performance is not impacted. In the next slide, we will see measured results for this EOS protection scheme. This slide shows how the unidirectional TVS diode on the input can be used to prevent an overvoltage condition on the off channel from impacting the on channel operation. Notice that this example uses a single supply configuration with an 18.5-volt supply. The input overvoltage signal applied to the off-channel is a 16-volt peak-to-peak sinusoidal wave with a 12-volt offset, so that the input ranges from positive 4 volts to positive 20 volts. The on-channel is connected to a 5-volt DC signal. Notice that a unidirectional TVS diode is used here because it is a single supply configuration. In this case, any negative voltage will cause the diode to be forward biased and limit the input signal to about negative 0.7 volts. The reverse breakdown is set at 18 volts, so if the input signal exceeds 18 volts, the TVS will clamp the input signal to 18 volts. The measured waveforms show the overvoltage signal on the off channel is clamped to 18 volts. The signal on the on channel is 5 volt DC, and this signal is coupled through to the output unaffected by the overstress signal applied to the off channel. That concludes this video. Thank you for watching. Please try the quiz to check your understanding of this video's content.